Conservative Book Club members, thank you for listening to our weekly author interview podcast series. I'm Chris Malagisi, editor-in-chief of the Conservative Book Club, now with over 700,000 members nationwide. Today we have a very special exclusive author interview with David Limbaugh, the author of the new book, The True Jesus, Uncovering the Divinity of Christ in the Gospels, published by Regnery Publishing. This is the third book in a series of best-selling books that Limbaugh has written about the Bible and Christianity, including Jesus on Trial and the Emmaus Code. Limbaugh writes a very popular weekly column I'm sure many people are familiar with and is a distinguished lawyer, political commentator, served in the National Guard, and is a frequent guest on national television and radio shows. But what I think really makes David Limbaugh stand out is the articulate, judicious, and detail-oriented nature of his books, making the case for or against a certain topic. No doubt that many people have become Christians or even had their faith emboldened after reading many of his books, but in particular his two previous books on the topic, and will no doubt again help many people realize the true power of the Gospels, especially in this Easter season. And it's already getting tremendous buzz as Sean Hannity endorsed the book, saying that, quote, David Limbaugh strikes again. The True Jesus is a brilliant must-read book on the real Jesus of Scripture, destined to be another bestseller. If you have faith, they will deepen it. If you don't, you just might change your mind after reading it. Quite a powerful endorsement. David, congratulations on your new book, The True Jesus, and thank you for joining the Conservative Book Club
today. Thank you, Chris. Really appreciate it.
So, David, tell us about your new book and why you decided to write this one, especially after your last two.
I wanted to pick up where the Emmaus Code left off. The Emmaus Code was an Old Testament primer, as well as, are primarily focusing on the Old Testament's pointing to Christ through prophecy, typology, and other ways, and prophecy, showing that Jesus is hinted at, foreshadowed, and typified in the Old Testament, and which is counterintuitive to people. Because that was kind of a survey, Christ-centered survey of the Old Testament, because I want to help orient people to the Bible who haven't otherwise been, I want to carry through and do the New Testament now. So I started with the idea of doing a primer or an introduction or a survey to the New Testament. And as I got into it, I realized that to do this justice, to get any depth at all, as opposed to be spreading out, I would have to focus on the Gospels alone. Because I started, there's got to be a way to, some method that you can discuss all 27 books of the New Testament, some hook, like I did in the Old Testament, I focused on the foreshadowings of Christ. I didn't discuss everything in the Old Testament except in the general sections because it would be unwieldy, it'd be 10,000 pages. On this one, I could do what a seminary book surveys do and just hit the highlights of each book. But then I wouldn't accomplish what I wanted to accomplish, which is to go in depth and inspire people to read the Bible itself and to give the actual substantive words of the Bible in many cases. So I called Regnery and asked if I could reduce the scope of this, narrow the scope to the Gospels alone. They readily agreed. And I started examining, reading the Gospels deeper, more deeply than I'd ever read them before. I've read them many, many times. But I'd always preferred reading the epistles, the Pauline epistles, or the other epistles, because they were more theological, and I get into theology. The Gospels record the relevant aspects of the life of Jesus. The Acts, of course, is the history of, mostly the history of the early church. But the Gospels are where you encounter the living Son of God, His words and deeds. And the more I got immersed in Him, the more evident that was to me in a way that was different than I'd ever encountered before. It's not that I had an epiphany, because I'd read them so many times, but I think I got a richer, deeper experience this time. Because when you want to write a book, at least in my case, I want to thoroughly research it, and you have to focus your mind to make the book digestible to people. You can't just include it. And I do have long, comprehensive books on purpose, because I want to be thorough, but I also want to be deep in what I do to choose to discuss, to give people some benefit of what I've learned. And so the Gospels, I decided to consolidate all four Gospel accounts because I wanted to give a cohesive picture to introduce beginning readers who might be intimidated by the Gospels or the Bible itself, mm-hmm. who don't know where to begin. What is this? What do you make of this? Because people have helped me. They've mentored me. I want to help other people. And I believe as Christians we have a duty to do that, and there's nothing wrong with writing books about the Bible. In fact, it's awesome to do that. Have Bible teachers, pastors, whatever. We all help each other learn and share what we've learned, and that's proper and advisable. It's not appropriate to alter the text. It's not appropriate to present your own work as if it's somehow inspired. And so, and I don't even think it's proper to try to harmonize the Gospels perfectly and suggest they can be perfectly harmonized into some cohesive chronological account, because many, many scholars before have tried this, and they just don't lend themselves to perfect, you know, because some of the Bible, the Gospel writers wrote in thematic ways and not in chronological ways, in a chronological order. But you can find a basic chronology, and it makes it more sensible to the reader if you do structure it some way like that. It's not a systematic theology, mm-hmm. the Gospels aren't, but you try to approximate the chronology to the extent that you can. So there are like 250 substantive events in the Gospels, the way some people organize them. And I had software to help with that, and I have a bunch of different harmonies, borrowing from scholars before and picking out what I think makes the most sense. So I summarized and condensed and combined the Gospels, always staying true to the text when I paraphrase. Most often, in the words of Jesus, put his words verbatim, even his long discourses, Sermon on the Mount, put it on. And then throughout this running chronicling, I interject commentary in every section from experts and my own insights, trying to help the reader understand what they've just read. But the foremost overarching purpose for all of this is to inspire readers to go to the source themselves. Books about Jesus are great. The books of God, the book of God about Jesus, the Bible and the four Gospels are what we need to read. And you get a different perspective from all different Gospel writers. Even though I combine these, it's for the purpose of facilitating the reader's knowledge and advancing their learning curve and helping them overcome their obstacle of intimidation so they can delve into the Gospels themselves. So that's what I've done, and I hope I've accomplished that to some extent.
Well, you talked just a little bit about this, but I'm very curious about your process of this, because it is very daunting for many people to read the Gospels, let alone the whole Bible, and then be able to process it and do it and write something that you've written in the structure that you've done it. Can you walk us through a little bit how you do that? I mean, how you're able to synthesize that, how long it took you? Are you a morning writer, an afternoon writer? Or how do you write something like this? And did you seek help with other theologians or religious experts?
I'm not a morning or afternoon or evening writer. I'm an all-day writer. When I write, research and write, I'm intense, do it 24/7, but I do it 7 days a week, and probably 12 hours a day or whatever it is. And I do it that way. I do a lot of research before I get into it. So I might spend months of general research, but it's not focused. And I remember one other writer before I'd written my first book. In fact, it was my friend Ann Coulter. I said, the more I research, the more I realize how little I know. And I'm getting overwhelmed. I don't know how to focus. I don't know how to narrow this. I was Clinton Reno Justice Department, my first book, Absolute Power, mm-hmm. with Ray Green. I'm just totally overwhelmed. She says, start writing the book and it'll focus. It'll force you to focus. So that's what I've always known since. I've thanked her profusely for that advice, because what I do is beginning with each book, I generally research. I research in a general way, read as much as I can. In the case of the Gospel, I read through the whole New Testament again, because I thought it was going to be the whole New Testament until I narrowed it. Then I read the Gospels, of course. Then I start reading commentaries. I read all kinds of books on it in my software. I have 23,000 books in my Logos Bible software. I'd have to buy them. They come with certain books, but over the 20 years I've accumulated these books, they're all searchable. And so I read these and I make note files in the software. And I really long, like 100 pages of notes, and then sometimes different kinds of files, and I always go back to them. The funny thing is, when I start writing, I found that I don't naturally necessarily go back to my note files. I'm going on the topic, and then I'll research anew. But the research that I did preliminarily will help me understand what I'm researching later, so it's not a waste. But number two, I always go back to it as a checklist and see if I've forgotten to include insights that I've made in those notes. And so basically, generalize my research, and however narrowly I focus preliminarily, and then I start the intense process of writing, and I spend like 3 to 3.5 to 4 months writing, and it's my first draft. I am not like some people who are anal, excuse my language, about getting it perfect the first time. That's not the way I work. That's not the way my mind works. I believe I have to have continuity and not interrupt my train of thought, my stream of consciousness, get it all down on paper fast. And then I go back after I've written the whole thing. I don't even try to preliminarily edit. I don't even try to superficially edit until I'm done with the whole thing. And then I'm done with the whole thing. I go back meticulously, painstakingly, and it's painful. And so I edit the whole thing. It may take me a month. So 3 months to go through a whirlwind of doing it. But you have to understand, I do a bunch of research before that. Mm-hmm. The 3 months of intense writing. Then the month of self-editing, rigorous self-editing. Then I submit it to my editor, and he gets the whole thing back and forth. I have great editors. And Jack Langer used to work regularly. He's now still my editor. And then he sends his revisions to me, and then I revise his or tweak his. Mm-hmm. He revises me again, then we send it to edit, and it keeps going. So it's a really a thorough process, but mine is not to do it as I go along. It's to do it when I'm done the first time.
And David, it's a wonderful book, and for anybody who does believe, it's a wonderful reminder and a great narrative in trying to understand the Gospels, and for those that are questioning, don't know, and that are open to it, it's a wonderful book for them too, especially during this Easter season. So congratulations to you on that. Thank you so much for joining us today at the Conservative Book Club. And Conservative Book Club members, make sure to check out The True Jesus, Uncovering the Divinity of Christ in the Gospels by David Limbaugh. You can see his book page and author page on conservativebookclub.com and buy it today this Easter season. David, thank you again. Thank so you. Much.